Okay, we're going to start the fourth turn here. As a little reminder of what we did last turn, we had the initiative roll. The reds have won the initiative, and we did the random events, and the whites got the AIF offensive chit, which is a very rare occurrence, but we're going to see if we can make the best of that this turn. The reds, if you recall, received another red terror result, which let them convert a city that they control, essentially becomes a red city. And they chose, what is it? Yeah, Izhvesk here, right? A resource city is now a red terror city, which greatly dampens the Siberian forces' hopes that maybe they could recapture some resource hexes here to stave off allied withdrawal. It's gonna be much more difficult now because not only is Izhvesk, a red city, but so is Perm up here, the one that we managed to take out the red unit out there last turn. But this is going to be a difficult city to hold because it is a red terror city. And while it would be wonderful to exploit this sort of, oh man, I made a little mess there. I need to get my tweezers out. They're across the room. There we go. Maybe this will help. Oh yeah, I hope they didn't move. No, they were right there. The truth is, I would love to exploit this sort of open area here, but we just don't have the ability to do so, having lost our sort of center here. The partisans really, really doing a terrible job on us there. That was probably a rookie mistake to not garrison this town, Ufa, to not send a unit there. I wasn't expecting partisans to show up. I knew about the threat on the Central Asian front, but I did not expect it on the Eastern front there. And the loss of the Cossack units really hurts us here. So, as much as I want to use the ability to kind of take advantage of this weak area, especially with the AIF offensive chit, which hopefully we can use to do some damage around there, but also especially right here, I'm hoping we can launch an attack here. Yeah, that should just work out. I just would like to have had better advantage here in the Siberian front. You can really press the Reds here because the Southern front shouldn't take a lot of attention. Really, this should be the primary front of attention because the Siberians do present a greater threat. But having lost the Cossacks, having lost, some unfortunate battles and won very little in return, we're going to have to play the defensive game here, essentially. The reason I'm kind of babbling on about the East Front is that the next phase we have to conduct is strategic movement, and the non-phasing player goes first. So that's the whites this turn. There's really nothing we want to move. We can move 2 points in the Siberian and AFSR units. The Siberians really don't have anything to move here. Although I am contemplating moving a unit out of Perm and maybe to Ufa because I can use the trail network. We can't see it goes up here to Omsk off camera and comes back this way. I still have that kind of rail network in effect. So I could reinforce Ufa, which is a natural sort of target for this red force to come out. They don't really need to take Perm. I mean, they will because there is white presence there and it's a red city, so it's easy to attack. But honestly, Siberians, if they're smart, they're going to try to pull out and get out of there without suffering too many losses, especially with these very unique units, which are kind of left hanging out to dry right here. Unfortunately, the Reds won initiative, so they get to choose what chit they want first. And I have a feeling they'll probably pick the East Front because that's just too tempting of a target. So maybe it would be smart to kind of get guys out of here. Get rid of your old writing. Maybe it would be smart. Let's go ahead and get this unit because it is unique, and if we lose it, we can't get it back. And the other unit, if we lose, well, yeah, I mean, we can eventually get it back, hopefully, at some point. We've lost so many, though. I kind of feel bad showing this as a video. I feel like I'm rusty at playing this, and the whites I've just played kind of terribly. And it's my one thing about this game is that if you play this with someone else, make sure you give the experienced player the reds. I feel like the Reds, they have their own challenges, but compared to some of the fragility of the Whites, if you really mess up as the Whites or get overextended or make a few bad or rash moves, it can just have long-term consequences. So we'll go ahead and take the Capel unit. I guess technically, oh, I can only move one of these. I could, if there were 2 ones, I could move them because I can move up to 2 points, but I'll just move the Capel unit. And he's going to go, and he's going to hang out in Ufa. Is that really going to be a smart move, though? I mean, it kind of is, because if they attack Ufa, it's just going to be a one unit. However, if I bring this guy in here, he brings negative 3 to defense. This guy only brings negative 2, and he does have one more unit. I think that's what we'll have to do then. We're going to take out the first Siberian. He's going to train over here, and he's going to kind of reinforce Ufa. And the reason he's going to do that is, even though I did want to kind of protect this, I guess I don't want this guy to face, I don't know why I'm trying to move this guy, because I don't want him to face any kind of combat. It's probably just smarter to move this guy here. He's one more point, so it's going to be harder to get greater odds on him. And his negative factor is only negative 2. So we'll just see what we can do here. That's probably the best we can hope to salvage in the Eastern Front. If we go back down to what we've encountered here in the Southern Front, not much we can move there. They're pretty much got their backs against the wall. Some pretty unfortunate moves. Got some units sacked there. Oh! Well, that happens every now and then, doesn't it? Traumatic camera experiences. Ooh, where did you go? Where did you come from? Well, we'll take a look at the videos. I'm pretty sure he was here, right? Because he was probably just totally damaged. But we'll check the videos in a second, and we'll make sure before we move him, that's where they go to the right place. Gotta get that camera stability on. So as you can see, we have nothing really we can transport here. So, not going to use strategic movement there. That means we're going to move on to the red strategic movement, which again, if we look at the map, there is not a lot for us to move, actually. We could maybe move this guy, but there's nowhere for him to go, right? There's nowhere for the rail network to connect. He's pretty much stuck in Simbirsk. I could move the Volsk, this army. I guess I could move that army. There's nothing really threatening here, but he can also just move up and help secure this front. I think that's going to be more important than him kind of supporting this already pretty overpopulated attack up there. I am kind of worried about the AIF up there, but I have no forces to spare. And I do have two kind of full-strength armies, so we're just going to have to hold. Hope they can hold up there. Okay, so that's pretty much strategic movement. Let's see what we have next. Now we do the basic command phase and determine what chits we're going to put in. Of course, because the Reds won the roll, they get to choose where they want to go first. And I think we will choose the East because we can press our advantage there the best. So I think we'll start with the East. We automatically get the field staff chit. And we'll go ahead and take the Southern chit again. Of course, the Whites get all their normal chits. And the logistics chit. Okay. We also have this cavalry raid chit. I kind of forget about this, but we have this other chit we can use any time with the cavalry unit. I don't know when it's going to come into play, but we'll see. Kind of forget we have that, but we should always be keeping that in the back of our mind, that we have the cavalry raid chit. Okay, so we've done that, and the East is going to go first. I'm going to stop real quick because I want to make sure I get this unit that may have been separated from his other units there. All that. What's the Kuban? I bet I could figure out through deduction if he was in this battle or not. Oh yeah, he could have been. Okay, I'm gonna take a pause and I'll be right back. Okay, looking over the, I guess as they say, with the miracle of TV, I was able to look at the video and realize that guy actually was there. So the Kuban Cossack, he was damaged, he goes there, he survives the camera fall. Hey, we fixed it, it's wonderful. So, as we said, we're going to do the first chit. It's going to be the Eastern chit, because I think we can definitely do some damage there. Damage against myself, since I'm playing myself, which is always an interesting, you know, fun thing about solo war games, right? Playing against yourself. As the Fish song goes, you enjoy myself. Maybe that's the closest thing I've ever come to that title, being understood. Okay. Throw out to Fish fans there, probably. If there's any of them watching that, that's a very interesting intersection of war games and Fish fans, maybe. Okay, so we're doing the East Front. What can we do here? Well, the partisans are just in a, you know, really nice spot. They don't need to do anything, and they can't even help with attacks anyway, so they're just going to sit pretty. They could actually, because they don't need supply, they could start beginning to really kind of move the... they've done their kind of damage there. I guess suppose because they have supporting armies moving up here and I can move these guys up and take Samara, which I think will be the first thing we do. These partisans technically could start moving over and taking cities that we need for red control. if we were playing the long game here, which we'll see if we keep playing how long. I'm not especially fast at recording turns sometimes. This is so easy to record though. I don't know why I do it more often, but anyway, I could keep taking cities, which would be smart, right? Because you need to kind of, this is one of the few units in the game that has like total flexibility of movement because it does not draw supply, it does not have to worry about zone of control. It can convert towns for your, I believe it can convert towns for your use. I don't think there's any restriction that says they can't. So it's one of those few units that if you get it and you can actually use it properly and get the effect you need, they can be a very useful unit. So maybe it might be worth it for us to just keep moving down and taking other towns with our partisan bands there. As it is, it's fairly useful though to have them there cutting supply off here from Samaras. So there's no hope to get any reinforcements or anything there, which there's no guarantee we'll be able to take Ufa or do what we want to do here. So maybe if I want to move them here, that would be nice. Because another letter phase is coming up, and that's when reinforcements can show up or replacements. So it might be nice to actually have a unit in Orenburg so the Orenburg Cossacks don't come back, but I think we'll just keep them there actually, because maybe, well, and I say that, I just don't know. But I don't really want Samara to get open, and I don't really want Ufa to, or this is not even a city, it's just there. Oh, that's great, then I think we will just do that. I thought it was like a city there, I don't know why, but that was my whole thinking. It's like, oh, he's holding a city, not holding a city. So yeah, we'll just go ahead and march him out here and go 1, 2, 3, and Orenburg will now fall under Soviet benevolent control or malevolent, depending on your point of view. And we will move this army up here. We'll stay on this river, on the Volga. This one will also, actually, he'll just come up here because this is actually a smarter play. Let's enter there, and they will eventually attack that garrison. That should be a fairly easy combat. The real question, though, is that we have sort of advantages here, and we have some units in the open that are unique, and we can definitely do some damage, right? And we have the advantage of also being able to leave a garrison in Izhevsk, which will be a red city, which is wonderful for us. And we have some very powerful full-strength armies ready to rumble here. So what is a more tempting target? Should we take on Ufa, which only has 3 points, but it is a city and it's on a river? Or do we take on some of these units that are just kind of hanging in the open and have very minimal defensive power? And honestly, the smart play, the smart move is take the units in the open, right? I'm not really worried about the Siberians trying to outmaneuver me and come and cut me off. I mean, they might do that. That's sort of a desperate play for them at this point. And they would need exceptional mobility to do so. And in this game, no unit has exceptional mobility. They pretty much all have universal movement values of 3. The Konarmea that comes out later has a movement value of 4. So there's no real grand maneuvers in the Russian Civil War in this game. It's really pretty much just brute force and controlling the rail lines. So I think what we're going to do is just brute force our way up here and take on these guys. It'll be fairly easy because they're just 1 and 2 value units. So, especially this check, it's so powerful. So let's go take that unit out. Move those guys there. He'll come up here and he'll hold Izhevsk. There you go. 1, 2. He could go there. Yeah, why not? It does lead me to counterattack potentially, but I'm willing to risk it because I think it'll be worth it to get the huge odds shift on these guys. Yeah, okay. Let's start with the combat in Samara, right? So, what do we have here? We have essentially 8-1 combat odds. Yeah, so he gets a shift only for being in the city, so that becomes essentially anything that's over 8-1 becomes 4-1, and then you just shift from there, I believe. Because the combat results table only goes to 4-1 odds. So let me double check on that. And I should probably pause, but I won't. Sorry. Just gonna look it up. Determinant odds. Treat odds less than 1 to 3 or greater than 4 to 1 after column shifts as 1 to 3 or 4 to 1 respectively. So essentially, even though I have 8 to 1, the column shift will be 7 to 1, it still just becomes a 4 to 1 combat, the greatest odds allowed. So we essentially have a 4 to 1 combat. We now roll the multiplier and figure out our modifiers.
And where are my trusty die?
Here they are. Okay, one of those fun rolls of 1 and 3. So the Soviets brought 2 units in, times 1 is 2. They also have a plus 3 bonus, that's 5 to the roll. And the Whites have a 3, they have 1 unit there, it's 3, but they have a minus 3, so it's essentially 0. So I have a 4 to 1 with a plus 5 differential, and a 4 to 1 with a plus 5 is Defender Retreats. Could have, if I'd gotten a 3 differential, could have suffered actually a loss there for the attacker, which goes to show that even at 4 to 1 odds, you can still suffer losses, which is kind of the attritional nature of this game, right? So there goes the Samaran garrison unit. It is toast. And we'll go ahead and advance this army there. So Samara is taken. Not really getting too lucky here with the Whites with some of these attritional battles, which are foregone conclusions, but nonetheless should hopefully yield you some losses, right? Not really happening here, and it's not very good for us. Okay, so here comes the 4th Army with the Latvian Rifles, the highly trained sort of super supporters of the Bolsheviks. They're going to come in against a second check there. We'll go ahead and do that panel. What do we have here? We have 5 to 1 odds. There's no defensive shifts here because the checks are just clearly hanging out in the open. Actually, they're on a river, and they're not on a river, so actually they do get a shift in their favor. But it still becomes 4 to 1, unfortunately, so it's 4 to 1 odds for them. Go ahead and roll the die. We get a 4 and a 5 result, so what do? We take 4 times 2 is 8, and we add in the additives here, which is 5, so that's 13. 5 times 1 is 5, plus 1 is 6, so that gives us a differential of 7 on the 4 to 1 chart. And that is a defender retreats, or defender takes a loss, or everybody, it's actually a capital D, so everybody would take a loss, but there's just one unit. So that unit takes a loss and retreats, and I think it will go 1, 2, we'll start heading the mountains here, and they will advance. I wonder if they could advance, and that technically would put them out of supply. I wonder if they could advance there, because that technically is out of supply, because this unit has zone of control, this unit has zone of control there. So I wonder if you can do that. Let's take a look. Yeah, units that are in supply may not advance after combat into the hex, which is out of supply. So technically, even though he beat that unit, he does not get to advance, which was maybe a little break for the Whites. Not much of one, though. Interesting. Another one of those can't move out of supply rules exemplified. Okay, we're doing the battle here. We have a total of 8 to 2, which is 4 to 1, right? And he doesn't get the river shift because we actually have a unit attacking from the river. So it stays at 4 to 1, and we roll the die. Ooh, interesting. 1 and 4. So we get basically a 2 for the reds, plus 6 is 8 differential. And the 4 for the whites, because he gets 1 there. So it's only a plus 4 on the 4 to 1. Again, that's just a capital DR. So getting really close with the Whites, but not quite able to really get that attritional effect going on, and they're just really suffering the entire consequences. So he suffers a loss and will retreat too as well. Now this time he actually can advance because we can actually stay in supply. And I think that army will just go there. Yeah, that seems to work for me. I'm not too, well, yeah, that'll work. Okay, so that's the Eastern Front. Making some nice gains there, really pushing the Whites back. That is sort of the goal of the Reds, even though it sort of extends them further and further out. We want to push this force back so that we can take surplus forces, such as these guys. We won't necessarily need them, we can start shuttling down the southern front. Okay, so let's take a look who comes next on the chits. Oh, what do you know? Southern front. Okay. So what are we going to do here? That's a great question. The whites have some weakened units, but they also have a pretty nice stack here. And we kind of want to take advantage of the red train and only takes effect during the logistics segment. Because we have a lot of weakened armies in this area, and it would be really nice to get that bolstering power. But let's see, we have 2, 3, 4, 5 stacking unit power, manpower, I forget what they call it there. So we have 5 there. I could get just 12 around it, which would be what? That would be only 2-1. Not necessarily great odds. But at the same time, if I can get, let's see, what a 2-1, I would have to get a pretty high differential on attack. Although I do have some good units that could actually, a +6, and they have, -2. So it'd be so far 0. They would only get a +1 on defense, but they have so many units that if they roll high, we could suffer quite the negative result there. This is where the kind of I'm sort of just fiddling with stacks and I'm making them all jitter all over the place. This is the kind of question where you look at it and go, do I want to even move guys here and attack? I kind of have the advantage because they're sort of bottled in here. But at the same time, the next turn, a lot of reinforcements will come in and this entire area opens up, which will give them some maneuverability, but not total because they're kind of bottled in. But oof, an attack may not be the best idea, but at the same time, I do have kind of surplus forces here. Even on a 2-1 attack, though, I need to get at least a +10 differential. So I'd have to beat them in the roll significantly. It's just going to be too tough, I think, to really do that. So what I think what I'll do is, I can't stack guys, and I'm not totally afraid of their attacks. I think what I'll do is I'll pull this unit back to Tsaritsyn. That way he can take advantage of the train effects there. And surprisingly, we won't initiate combat. I don't want to do that unless I could have 3 full strength armies, because I really want that +3, even though getting +6, and I really wish I could get, if I can actually do that, then what I can do is move this guy here, well, I can only get up 3, I guess. We'll have to see. I would rather have full strength armies take them on, and honestly, with the advantages I've gotten, I don't need to press too much here. So I think that's okay. Sort of a no-nothing turn there, but I think we're just going to have to wait because we didn't get the logistics chit. And honestly, I think the Cossacks here, they'll probably try to make an aggressive move, but they're really limited in their sort of options there, although they probably will have the ability to really wage some combat there, so I kind of wonder if I should have attacked them. Should I attack them? 3, and they have 5 units. I mean, they can just get so much, but I would get a nice, it's just 2-1. They do suffer things as long as I get a 0 or higher differential. Ooh, this is one of those risky maneuvers. Should I do it or should I not? No, I'm not gonna do it, because even if they sort of trip me here with a combat, they can only really damage one unit at a time. They can't really afford to move their forces or split them. And even though this is a 5 stack here, this is a 4, so they could get 1-1 combat. But man, they really can't afford to take many losses. They're going to be very careful with their combats here. So, yeah, I think we're going to have to just say, that's it. That's it. I'm going to hold to it. Not really pressing it here in the south. That could be a mistake. We'll see. We'll see. Soviets really just going all in at first, getting the field staff chit here. That's really going to help us, because I would maybe like to do something about tackling the AIF here, because I could just go up and attack them, but I think I'll just make them come attack me because I have defensive positions. But what I will do is hopefully I could move in this town, get a nice shift.
I'm a little bit afraid of this combat because it's going to be that. So I think maybe what we'll do is we'll just pull back. To Tashkent. We'll just hold up in that city and make them come to us. And I need to research if we have to use the AIF chit this turn. If we don't have to, I can save it and keep the threat alive. If I do have to use it, then that unit just escaped annihilation, essentially. Okay, that was pretty easy, field staff. I just don't have a lot of units on the board, so that was a pretty easy call. I don't have any other armies I want to move, otherwise I would have strategic moved them earlier. So yeah. Alright, next chit. Armed Forces of South Russia. So here we are with these guys, and again, we sort of know that they don't have a lot of options. I can definitely gang up on a unit and maybe deny them from getting a full surround, so maybe their hesitancy will give me some advantage here. So we'll take these guys and go. See, they have four and four, so they can definitely do that. And, oh, the Tareks. They're over here, aren't they? So how far can they go? They can only go eight hexes from... Oh, sorry, you can't really quite see it. If you remember, Cossack units can only operate within eight hexes of their home Krug. So it's one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Yeah, he can go to Rostov, so... We'll go ahead and just go one, two... like that, and we will just beat the living hell out of this ninth army, hopefully. So we sort of calculate the odds here. That's 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 to 4, so we are getting 2-1 odds. He is in the open. Let's go ahead and roll these dice. All right. Got a 4 and a 2 results. This is going to be good for us because obviously we have superior numbers of units. His differential is just going to be a 4, right? Because he's got +2 for defense, and he just rolled. He's a 1 unit, and he's got 2, so that's 4. Meanwhile, I have a -1 here, a +1 with that, a 0, now a 2, a 4, 6. So I have a +6 off just my modifiers and my units, and then I get 4 times my number of units here. So that's 6 plus this. It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? It's 1, 2, 3, 4. I guess maybe I should have attacked. I thought there were 5 units here, but there's just 4. Maybe I should have attacked here. That might have been a little silly, but that's okay. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 times 4 is 24, and with 30, so I believe we definitely get the maximum we can get. So on a 2-1 attack at the maximum differential, we get a capital D retreat. So this guy does indeed flip, and he has to move. But see, that wasn't so bad for the Reds, because again, he has to retreat, but he can just go 1-2 and hang out with the red train there. And then he'll also receive the benefits of getting the rally. So it actually was not that bad for the not that bad for the Reds at all. The big question is, do I want to advance up here and potentially put myself back in the pincer, the surrounding pincer, and I don't think I want to do that. I think we're just going to hold back. Next chit. Logistics. So let's take a look at our sequence of play, make sure we get this correctly done. All right, if logistics, we do the white supply steps. We check for supply for all friendly units. The AFSR is clearly in supply because they can trace there. The whites are in supply because they can all, actually technically, ruh-roh, this guy is not in supply. Oh, that's really bad. I didn't realize that. I should. Oh, I didn't think about that. Damn, I would have moved that guy, honestly, if I could have gotten the ability to do so. But he is being cut off because he cannot trace supply there. If he cannot trace supply, I believe he automatically suffers a step loss, or he's marked out of supply. Maybe he gets one turn to actually get his shit together. Oops, that makes us explicit. Sorry. Sorry if you're under, like, 12 and you heard that. It happens. Let's make sure we know what out of supply does. Okay.
Yep. Suffers a disorder result. I've kind of forgotten about that rule because it's been a couple days since I played, so I forgot. So he actually dies. Oops. That is a irreplaceable unit that just died, so the whites are getting... This is just actually a terrible game for the whites. I feel really bad. The whites should not be suffering this bad, but this is my sort of inept play combined with some really good red draws and great combat results and just sort of inadvertent great advances there. I did not even realize that Perm was cut off from supply there, so boo. Boo for the whites, boo for me. Everybody else is in supply. That guy's in supply. These guys are all in supply. Everybody up there. So nobody's really threatened. This game is not all about threatening supply that much. It's pretty difficult to do that. When you can, it's devastating, obviously, by the rules effects, right? Okay, so we did the supplies. Now we'll do the white rally step, and then we'll do the red rally step because we know they're in supply as well. We can also remove garrisons and do what we want to do here. And we're not going to even do that because I don't think there's any garrison I need to remove. Yeah, so let's go ahead and do the rules here for rallying our units. I believe we're going to need, according to our handy-dandy aid sheet here, for... Let's go ahead and do the AFSR units, and they're going to need a 1 or 2, right? Okay, so we have... Actually, I had it on there, but we're going to do these guys first, sorry. So what do we have? We have the Don Cossacks here, and I think they're the only one not rallied. Yeah, so we're going to roll for the Don Cossacks. They do not rally. We'll go ahead and do the Kuban right next to them. The Kuban do rally. It's a nice bit of luck. It's actually a very nice bit of luck. Stack has not gone yet, so they actually can... Oh, they did go, actually, didn't they? Yeah, they did. So, well, that helps in the future, right? Okay, they rallied. So now we'll go up to our friends in the Siberian front. And we'll go ahead and do the first Siberian there. They do not narrow... They narrowly miss it. And we'll do the people and the Czech underneath. The people do not... Check do not. So white's not really getting good rolls here. Let's go ahead and do the reds now. The reds have to do the same thing, although we know that these units automatically get rallied because of the presence of the red train. So you can see automatically that, like, killing disordered units is huge because I wasn't able to kill any of these guys, and they all were able to run back up here and instantly rally because of a prudent use of the red train. And so that's sort of devastating, right? Because now all of a sudden we have huge armies of forces there. Let's see what we got here. We have 13th Army there. We'll roll. It does not. I wonder if we can do that with partisans. Yeah, it's a red unit, so we'll check for the partisans as well. They do not. Everybody else is rallied. Yep, so that's it. So that's all the red units. That is pretty much the logistics phase. All right. Next shit is the AIF shit. Where are you there? Whee! Okay. So let's take a look at the rules. Let's double check to make sure if we have to use the AIF shit. See, if you look at this thing, sorry to be silent there for a second, but if you look at the player aid card, it says literally that any or all AIF units may attack this turn when the AIF chit is placed or played. Place the marker on the turn record check. So does that mean that I have to play it that turn? Or can I save it? Special units and markers. Let's see what it says here for the AIF chit. It does not say. All right, let's go to Oh, that's interesting. You think it would say it there, but it does not. And this is where I would love to have an index. There is not one. Combat. You think it would say something about the combat here. Okay, yeah. AIF units may attack only if white rolls event 6 that turn. So that seems to indicate, especially under Rule 11.2 for combat restrictions, that seems to indicate that you have to play it the turn you get it. So that's... Yeah, so this basically this unit in Tashkent is saved. We'll go ahead and move these guys up. 1, 2, and they'll just stay there. Just because that's the best they can do. The question is, should I even let these guys attack? Should they come down and do any damage there? That is a good question, one I am not so sure about. This is a 1-to-1 attack. This is a... God, those are just terrible. Those aren't even that good of odds. So no, because I just don't think those attacks are worth it. So that chit is actually kind of worthless. I don't think I'm going to be doing anything with that one. I guess I could come over here and attack, but that puts them out of supply. Yeah. You would have to get rid of this guy in order to come over here, or have to get rid of this guy, I guess, and you have to get rid of this guy to come over here and attack, so you have to have that rail line clear to get supply. So yeah, the AIF is not really going to do much there. I don't really see an advantage in having them. That's kind of frustrating, because you're like, oh, you get that event, and then you're like, oh, it does nothing, so the whites kind of have a do-nothing event. Although their modifiers are pretty sweet. This guy's not rallied, so he has actually -2, so it's not that great. I guess technically they could attack here. This lake is considered frozen during a winter turn, so they could trace to there. No, they can't actually trace, because they have to be one away. I guess technically they can go here and attack over the lake, which I believe is permittable because it's frozen. Yeah. I believe that's how winter rules work, and we are in our winter turn. Yeah, you can actually treat as a clear hex, so that's actually pretty interesting. I could come over here and attack, I guess, because I forgot that they have supply that can come here, and they could be adjacent there, and that could actually work. So maybe we'll make a daring attack over there. Yeah, that's what we'll do. We'll go 1, 2, 3. We'll make an attack on this. The AF is going to get a little brave, do a 3-to-1 attack, which becomes a 2-to-1 attack because of the city presence. Go ahead and roll our modifier die. Where's the white die? There it is. All right. Well, it hopped out. They both ended squarely, so it's a 5-to-4. That bodes well for the whites because they have 3 units. That's 15, and they have +6, but a -2, right? So that's actually +4. So 15 plus 4 is 19. This guy has a total of 2, so it's a +13. On a 3-to-1 attack. That's a DR result. So yeah, they'll get rid of this guy. All right, AIF, way to go. And we'll have these guys come in here. And they will have taken that city. Now, actually, we'll move them both in. Things stacked together. Way to go. This actually kind of sort of makes an advance on Petrograd possible later if we get the same draw and we have the ability to attack it. So, that's interesting. That's interesting. Okay. Next chip is the Siberian units. They, unfortunately, did not get to go before losing this city, and honestly, we are just going to have to be in total pullback mode. There's no ability to kind of hold Ufa. Without just being totally surrounded and cut off, we need to go into here and just kind of hang out in the mountains. It's unfortunate, but that's what we got to do. So we're going to go 1, 2, 3. They're going to hang out there. These guys will go 1, 2, and hang out there.
Is that weirdly sticking up? Yeah, just sort of a plexiglass issue, right? I mean, it's just the way it is. We're going to have to pull back and hopefully make the Red Army kind of come to us and extend their lines. And that's sort of the best we can hope for, because we don't have a lot going for us in the Siberian front, unfortunately, anymore. That leaves the last chit, of course, to be the Northern Islamic front. That is over here. And naturally, we're just going to move up here and sort of take 1, 2, 3, Samarkand. Okay, so that ends basically the winter turn. And what we'll do is when we come back in the next turn, since this is kind of a big turn, turn B, I think I'm going to do a whole separate video for that, because you bring a whole lot of units, just give you a little side view of that stack. We're going to bring a whole lot of units in. It's going to open up a whole part of the board here. It's going to open up actually this entire part and bring in some Polish units, some new rules for nationalist garrisons that will pop in over here. It's going to basically blow up the board a little bit, bring in more armies, and we'll do a little overhead view here of what's going on. Again, not a whole lot here, but a total rallying of the armies in the southern front. The AIF managed to take, Petrozavdovsk. See, if it was in Russian, I could read it totally, but when it's transliterated, I'm just a putz with it. And of course, the Reds are pushing here on the Siberians and really pushing them back. Probably what really historically occurred here, but unfortunate for our Whites in this case. Okay, as we have it, again, the Whites have 0 resources. The Reds have 7, way too much. Not looking so good. For the Whites here. I believe they do their first withdrawal check here. No, they don't. So they still have time to survive, maybe through good fortune or good luck, and get these resource cities back. But it's going to be an uphill slog. Definitely an uphill slog. Okay, when we come back, we'll do strategic turn B and then on to turn 5.